Begin this afternoon's session, which is largely about health-related topics, but also about the things that cause health problems. And the first speaker is Professor Lauren Ancel Meyers from the University of Texas at Austin. She's a member of the Science Board, and when I first met her, she had just finished her math major at Harvard as an undergraduate and did her PhD at Stanford. And then a postdoc, she was a Steinmetz Fellow of the Santa Fe Institute and split her time between the Institute and Bruce Levin's group, the famous bacterial ecology group at Emory, after which she moved to Austin to become an assistant professor, and she's now professor and director of the Section on Integrative Biology and Division of Statistics and Scientific Computation. She has a lab and also does the mathematical work, and was recently named by the MIT Technology Review as one of the top 100 global innovators under age 35. Lauren. She's going to be talking about tracking and curbing the next pandemic.
Okay, this is on? All right. Thank you so much, Mark. I give talks all the time, and I've talked to SFI on several occasions, but today I feel particularly nervous. And I think what Derek said in his last talk that he felt like he was sort of grew up at SFI, and in some ways I feel like I also grew up as a scientist here at SFI. And as I look out, I see all of my most important role models and mentors in the room, and so it's really an honor to be here today. So my formative experiences, starting at the Complex Systems Summer School, I believe in 98, and then as a Steinmetz Fellow, a postdoc fellow at SFI, and then many years on the external faculty, have really shaped me as a scientist. It influences the kind of problems I choose to work on, the methods I choose to use when approaching these problems, and the kind of intellectual culture I try to create at UT among my students and postdocs and collaborators. And when I was thinking about what I wanted to talk about today, I was looking through the SFI website, and I saw this right there, smack in the middle of the page, is sort of a mission or vision statement for SFI. It says, researchers come to SFI from universities, government agencies, research institutes, and private industry to collaborate across disciplines, merging ideas and principles of many fields from physics, math, and biology to social sciences and humanities in pursuit of creative insights that improve our world. Now, this really speaks to me today, but it's not how I would have characterized the SFI that I grew up in. In the 1998 Complex Systems Summer School, our work groups were focused on what does emergence mean? What are agent-based models? What is phenotypic plasticity, and how does evolution impact, or how does it? What are the evolutionary consequences of phenotypic plasticity? And other topics that were really are sort of centralized themes at SFI, but rarely, if ever, did we think about how advances on these topics, insights, would actually improve the world. Right? But I think that SFI has evolved since 98 and since even before that, and that the larger global community of SFI associated scholars has also evolved, at least in part, to really have more of an interest in taking the methods and taking the very fearless and interdisciplinary, out-of-the-box type approaches to problem solving out there to the real world to address problems that have to do with human welfare and the health of societies and ecosystems and the planet. So it's not surprising that a number of the talks in the symposium are addressing questions about human health and in particular infectious diseases. So infectious diseases are really appealing to SFI type scholars for a couple of reasons. First of all, they are enormously complex systems, as we've already heard from previous speakers today. The pathogens, the bacteria, the viruses, the fungi that cause infectious diseases have complex and evolving genomes, and the evolution and the transmission of these pathogens depends on the hosts that they infect. the physiology of the host, the immunity of the host, and even other co-infecting agents that are infecting the host. And within a single population, you're going to have quite a bit of heterogeneity in immune systems, in physiology, in past exposure to diseases. You may be interested in a pathogen that actually spreads through multiple different host species, or perhaps is transmitted by a vector species. In human populations, the way an epidemic will unfold will also depend on human behavior, on individual health-related decision-making, and on organizational decisions having to do with interventions. And then certainly there are going to be climate factors. Derek just talked about how you get different kinds of circulation of flu in tropical versus temperate regions. So in order for us to advance our understanding of infectious diseases and our ability to control the spread of infectious diseases, it really takes interdisciplinary efforts. It requires that virologists and microbiologists, bacteriologists get together with ecologists and physiologists and immunologists and climate scientists and sociologists, and the list goes on. And you really need all these people at the table to tackle some of the hardest problems around infectious diseases. And more, it's really critical that people with quantitative tools, people from physics, from math, from computer science, from operations research and engineering, come to the table and help us take advantage of the computational resources, the new modeling tools, and make sense of the volumes of data that are starting to flood in. So the other thing, so number one, infectious diseases are really complex systems of great interest to us as scientists. But the other reason they're very, I think, of interest to SFI-type scholars is because of their relevance to the real world and the ability to actually improve the world by making scientific advances. So as we all know, infectious diseases kill. And so for example, imagine that suddenly half the people that you knew started dropping dead from a really severe illness, a vector-borne disease. This is exactly what happened in the 1300s in Europe as bubonic plague basically wiped out 30 to 60% of the population in a matter of years. Smallpox has been a major plague on humankind until very recently. This is a disease that infected most kids before age 5 and killed about 20 to 30% of them. Even in the 20th century, somewhere around, it's estimated 300 million people died from smallpox. Smallpox is also a great success story for modern public health. An effective vaccine was developed at the end of the 1700s, and thanks to a universal vaccination campaign, it was declared eradicated from the globe in the 1970s. So those are sort of our historic plagues, but today we have modern plagues that claim the lives of at least 10 million people every year, the vast majority of whom are from developing countries, and at least half of whom are under age 4. Those diseases include tuberculosis and malaria and HIV AIDS. And each one of these diseases, and there are many, many others that are serious public health burdens, each one of these diseases spreads in different ways, comes with its own set of challenges as to how we should try to, how we can control them. And they also each seem to evade some of our best efforts at controlling them. Malaria and tuberculosis, for example, are ancient diseases. They've been with us since the dawn of humankind. And while we do have anti-malarial drugs and antibiotics that can treat tuberculosis, which is a bacterial disease, we now face growing epidemics of strains that are resistant to all medications that we have to treat them. HIV/AIDS, that's a very recent disease. It's been spreading widely since the 1980s in humans across the globe. And since then, already over 25 million people have died. It's been estimated, and there's at least that many infected today. So infectious diseases are bad, they kill, but we're not powerless, and we can make progress through interdisciplinary efforts. If you look at the United States in the 20th century, you'll see a major success story. So by 1900, every state in the US had a public health department. The first decades of the century, most public drinking water became sanitized. In the teens and the 20s, the first vaccines for major childhood diseases, including diphtheria and typhoid, came online. In the 40s, penicillin became mass-produced. And so you see, when you look at this and you compare, you compare deaths due to infectious diseases in the 20th century in the U.S. to estimates for deaths due to everything else that's not infectious diseases, what you see is we started the 20th century with about half of deaths being due to infectious diseases and ended the 20th century with a very small fraction of deaths being due to infectious diseases. So we made great strides through public health efforts. But the developing world still looks like the U.S. did in the 1900s, in the beginning of the century, where almost half of deaths in the developing world are due to infectious diseases. So today, I'm also going to be focusing on influenza. And fortunately, I came after Derek, and a few of my slides I'm going to get to just whiz through because he's already covered some of the basics. But I'm going to talk about flu in three parts. And I was invited here today to focus on how we are using network-based models to help advance our understanding of infectious diseases and control infectious diseases. And I am going to touch on that, but only briefly. I decided today instead, based on that mission statement I showed you earlier, to focus on some more applied areas of research where we're really directly interfacing with public health to develop model-based tools to help with preparedness and response to serious disease threats. So part one is going to be now a quicker overview of what we understand about flu and what we don't understand and some of the big outstanding problems. Part two is going to be what I call tricks of the trade. This is where I'm going to talk about network modeling and just some other things, some quantities, some concepts that basically infuse our work almost every day of the week. And then finally, I'll get to some of those examples from some recent contractual work we've done for the state of Texas Public Health Department. Okay, so flu 101. Flu is a major public health burden. In the United States, it leads to hundreds of thousands of hospitalizations and tens of thousands of deaths. And it's caused by a disease, it's caused by a virus, it's continually evolving, as we've just learned. And our primary mode of intervention is vaccines, and fortunately we have people like Derek out there helping us develop the most effective vaccines possible to slow or mitigate the spread of flu. But there are two other types of interventions that are widely used for flu. One are antiviral medications, and these are drugs that are thought to have taken early enough, within 24 hours, maybe 48 hours of symptom onset, taken earlier enough, can reduce the time that you have, can reduce your symptoms, the time that you're infectious, and basically make it so that you have less disease when you're infected. And then finally, the other category of interventions are the non-pharmaceutical interventions. We call them NPIs for short. These are social distancing interventions, other behavioral interventions, things like closing schools during pandemics, taking hygienic precautions, being better about washing your hands, in hospitals, using personal protective gear. And these things can be really important and really effective at slowing the spread of disease. And these are particularly important, a pandemic scenario where it may be many months before we have an effective vaccine available. We have a limited supply of antivirals, so this is going to be our key line of defense against a newly emergent strain. And I think importantly, the vast majority of resource of funding dollars, of grant dollars, go to pharmaceutical interventions, go to developing effective vaccines, antivirals, stockpiling them for preparedness. And I think an insufficient amount of time and resources and attention go to thinking about how we can more effectively use non-pharmaceutical interventions to mitigate the spread of a pandemic. And part of that involves understanding better what people's behavioral responses might be in the early stages of a pandemic. So we've learned a little bit about pandemics, and this slide is going to look a lot like one of the ones that Derek showed up there, but showed in his talk. But as he mentioned, there are many strains of flu that are continually circulating in wild waterfowl populations, and occasionally these strains make jumps into other animal populations, our domesticated poultry or swine populations, and into this documented transmission events into horses and some other wildlife, including sea mammals. And occasionally, if we're really unlucky, we get new strains introduced into the human population, potentially from wild water bird populations, but more likely via intermediate transmission through our domesticated animal populations. And when this happens, we have the potential to have a very large-scale epidemic. Because we have no immunity. The strain looks nothing like the ones that have recently been circulating in the human population. And so again, this is going to look, I'm just going to flash through this very quickly. This is going to look a lot like one of the slides that Derek showed you. But just to remind you, in the 20th century, there were three major pandemics. And this, what you're seeing here, is a time series showing that correlates with the amount of more mortality due to flu during the 20th century. So that big spike was the very virulent Spanish flu pandemic that's been more virulent, more deadly than any flu we've seen since. And then we had the Asian flu pandemic of 1957, which, as Derek mentioned, completely replaced this H2N2, completely replaced the H1N1 that had been circulating between 1918 and 1957. And then we have another replacement when the Hong Kong flu comes in 1968. One event on the pandemic front that Derek didn't mention was a scare, the swine flu scare that never developed into a pandemic in 1977. And this was an outbreak on a military base in New Jersey that was quite a virulent strain. People who got it got pretty sick, and a number of people died. Fortunately, it didn't spread beyond the military base, but because of concern about this new strain, Gerald Ford, who was president at the time, launched a universal vaccination campaign that was aborted after approximately 40% of the U.S. population was vaccinated because of a possible link between the vaccine and an immunological disorder called Guillain-Barré syndrome. Now, and it was also aborted midstream because they realized that this strain wasn't emerging into a pandemic. This is important not because we are seeing the strain today, but this is important because this is in recent memory. And when you think about who is actually going to be willing to be vaccinated when vaccines become available for the next vaccine, you have to realize that some people are very averse, and some people remember scares like this and are unwilling to be vaccinated because they fear that there are going to be complications. So moving on, so then we have the Russian flu introduction of H1N1, and one of the questions that is still not well understood that Derek touched on is, why does H2N2 come in and replace H1N1? Why does the Hong Kong flu replace the Asian flu? But when the Russian flu comes in, it doesn't replace the currently circulating Hong Kong flu strain, and the two persist together until 2009. We have the bird flu, the avian flu threat right now. H5N1 is still causing mortality around the globe, but fortunately is not spreading from person to person. And this is also important because fears about H1N1 have led to a large amount of resources and time being put to pandemic preparedness. So it's because of H5N1 that we've really seen in the last 10 years public health agencies from global to local really making plans for when that next pandemic is going to emerges. Now, in all that planning, most of the models, most of the discussion from 1977 on have been focused on that new strain, probably an avian strain, emerging out of Southeast Asia and then making its way around the globe. Well, what turned out to happen in 2009 was that it was a strain emerging out of a pig farm in Mexico City. In fact, 2 weeks before we became aware that there was this new strain that was emerging out of Mexico, I was in a meeting with the state of Texas's health department. We were talking about developing some models of how flu, a pandemic might spread in Texas. And someone in the room, a nurse, said, well, don't you think we need to, we were talking a lot about the major metro areas and the importation of cases through Houston's airport and Dallas's airport. And a nurse in the room said, well, don't we have to worry about the border? And the powers that be in the room, those in charge of pandemic preparedness, said, oh, we don't have to worry about the border. The next strains are going to come from Asia through one of our major airports. And not 2 weeks later, some of the first strains came over the border into the San Antonio area. So fortunately, we've had a lot of resources and a lot of time to think about pandemic preparedness, but unfortunately, we have no idea when that next strain is going to appear, where it's going to appear from, what it's going to look like. Is it going to be virulent? Is it going to be mild? How quickly is it going to spread? Although we have a good idea about that because flu seems to be fairly stereotypical in that respect. So then that takes us to 2009, the 2009 pandemic. Okay, so from flu epidemiologists look at graphs like this all the time. This is sort of a zoom in of the time series that I showed you in the previous graph. You have weeks going along the x-axis, and you have on the y-axis something that correlates with influenza activity across the US. And what you're seeing here is a number of seasons in a row. This first pair of peaks is the 2006-2007 flu season. Cases start rising when kids go back to school in the fall. There's an early peak in December, a dip when kids go home for winter break, and then our real peak in February, and then things die out for the summer. We see a very similar pattern in the 2007-2008 flu season, a very similar pattern in the 8-9 season, and then just when we expected flu to disappear for the summer, the strain emerges out of Mexico City, and we have a sizable summer wave in the US. That's that little peak right there. And then we have a massive wave that takes off the second kids go back to school in the fall, much earlier than our typical flu season, peaking in October. public health officials, and we did not know whether we would also see a wave at the normal time of year in February, and it wasn't really until we got out to February when we saw that there wasn't a typical flu season that we breathed a sigh of relief and said, okay, we're done for this year. Then we go back to, this is some of the statistics from the 2009 pandemic. As I said, fortunately, it wasn't a very virulent strain as we feared. It was sort of on par with typical seasonal strains in terms of morbidity and mortality in the U.S., approximately a couple hundred thousands of hospitalizations and somewhere between 8 and maybe 20,000 deaths in the U.S. attributable to flu. Then we go back to sort of business as usual, the 2010-11 season, a little peak in December, a big peak in February. And then this year is another anomaly. I don't know if you know it, but this year we've hardly had any flu. This is out till March, and it just continues to decline. This horizontal line across is the threshold CDC uses for declaring the start of flu season. We basically never cross that threshold. And there's a lot of hypotheses out there for why that is, but we really don't know. And nobody would have told you last year that we weren't going to have a flu season this year. So there's a lot of big questions, a lot of things we don't understand about even the macroscopic dynamics of flu in the U.S. Okay, so and what's next? I guess this slide is just up there to make the point that we don't know whether that next strain, again, is going to come out of Mexico, is going to come out of Asia, is going to come out of swine farms in the middle of the U.S. where we are seeing a new strain of H3N2 causing little outbreaks. We just don't know when it's going to happen, where it's going to come from, and how severe it's going to be. Okay, so that was the overview of flu, and now I'm going to move on to tricks of the trade. So like I said, these are just a few of the concepts and approaches that really are central to infectious disease epidemiology, and particularly those researchers who are thinking about modeling diseases. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is networks. Since I began working in this field, whenever I think about diseases, I think about networks. I think about those contact patterns in a human population or an animal population that lead to the transmission of disease. Okay? So you wake up in the morning, let's say you have a respiratory disease, you interact with your family or other household members, you have the potential to spread or catch disease from them. And then, so those are those little links. Then maybe you go to the coffee shop and bump into someone there, you get on your subway, you go to work, and all those people have contacts with each other, giving rise to a vast network of connectivity along which epidemics can spread. These are all part of a much larger network. This is supposed to be a cartoon of a network in a city where you have households and you have workplaces. And over the last, I'd say almost 15 years now, there's been a sizable group of researchers working on developing mathematical tools to help us understand what these networks look like and how they constrain the spread of disease, how they influence the spread of disease, and how by understanding what these networks are, we can develop better control strategies. So the basic idea is that we want to be able to understand what's going on in the real world. And so we try to extract what is that essential network, what are the patterns of connections that lead to contact patterns. And once we do that, we try to use mathematical and sometimes simulation-based methods to try to say something about how epidemics will spread. Now, we don't do a very good job yet on this first part, on trying to really, we don't really have a good handle on what those transmission networks look like or what the underlying patterns of connectivity look like. In our own research, we've used all different kinds of data sources to try to say something about what contact patterns for respiratory diseases might look like in an urban setting. Occasionally, we have very detailed data for a smaller system on who's coming into contact with whom. This is a cartoon from a study that Mark Newman and I did with some folks on the CDC on how walking pneumonia is spreading in small closed healthcare settings. We've worked on trying to understand network structures at a much larger scale. For example, the connectivity between different major cities in North America via air travel. But what I've found in my work is often it's much easier to know how animals come in contact with each other. For example, lions in the Serengeti on the other side of the earth, thanks to decades of work by wildlife ecologists, than it is for us to figure out how we're coming in contact with each other on a regular basis. So there's a lot of work to be done there. On the other arrow, once we know what the network structure is, can we say something about the epidemiology? We have made a lot of progress, and that's where the real exciting activity has been over the last decade plus. So the basic idea is you know what your network looks like, and you know something about the disease, how quickly it's going to spread, et cetera, how vulnerable your individuals are in your network, and you want to say something about the dynamics and ultimate outcome of an epidemic. And a lot of the methods that have been developed borrow from an area of statistical physics called percolation theory, which is a set of methods for modeling, for example, the flow of a fluid through some sort of material where you have opened and closed channels, and you want to know, based on the configuration of those channels, how the liquid is going to percolate through the material. And so here the analogy is the contacts are those channels, and the disease is your liquid, and the contagiousness of your disease is like the viscosity of the liquid. And the idea to use this kind of approach to thinking about infectious diseases was actually originally suggested back in the 80s, but it was actually folks at SFI in the early 2000s that really took the critical steps to making this a useful toolkit. So Mark Newman, Chris Moore, Duncan Watts, and I was involved in starting to apply these methods to some very practical problems in public health. And now these are three of the early papers, but now there are dozens of papers in this field developing and applying powerful methods for understanding those contact patterns and how they influence disease transmission. And just to give you a very quick synopsis of some of these sort of exciting things that have happened are, first of all, these kinds of methods have been used in very practical ways to improve our intervention measures, to come up with more effective strategies, for example, for using limited resources, better priorities for vaccines when you don't have enough to go around, for example. Priorities for who to give antivirals to if you don't have enough to go around. And these methods have been applied to a variety of diseases, including sexually transmitted infections and respiratory diseases like flu and like SARS. And we have expanded the toolkit so we can handle more and more complex types of networks. So we can explicitly, mathematically handle clustering in networks and dynamic contact patterns in networks and modularity in networks. And in many of the cases, the methodological developments are directly fueled by a real problem out there in the real world. We develop clustering methods because we want to have a better understanding of the role of households in the transmission of influenza. We develop methods for handling dynamic contacts in networks to get a better handle on the role of intravenous drug use in propagating HIV in high-risk communities. And finally, some very recent work is really trying to more explicitly model and understand the role of behavior in driving epidemics. So, for example, there have been recent attempts to merge network modeling and game theory modeling to understand how people's decisions around whether or not to vaccinate influence the spread of disease through a network. And it's giving us some very interesting new insights into the efficacy of different sorts of intervention strategies. So, and this toolkit, these examples of applications, these have been years and years of many researchers now working. I think the most exciting areas of kind of new kind of research in this field is on the inferring network structure. So, and we're going to hear about this afternoon some really nice talks about using 21st century data sources to try to better understand what social contact patterns look like. So, more inventive ways of using new kinds of data to try to better understand what those contact patterns look like. And there's also some work being done in the domain of trying to use epidemiological data. So, for example, you have flu data for year after year for the same population. Based on who got infected and when they got infected, can we say something about the underlying network, the network underlying the spread of that disease? So, again, inferring network structure from both sociological and epidemiological data. So trick of the trade too, so arguably the single most important quantity in infectious disease epidemiology is something we refer to as the reproduction number, or R-naught. This number is so important that in the recent blockbuster film Contagion, there's a whole scene devoted to Kate Winslet standing at the board explaining to everybody in America what R-naught is. Right? So what is R-naught? Well, it's a single quantity that roughly tells us how quickly and extensively a disease is going to spread through a population. So if your disease has a high R-naught, it might cause very rapid and explosive epidemics. If your disease has a lower R-naught, it may spread more slowly. Oh, that was the fast one. Okay, that's the fast R-naught. Okay, I guess this is, I don't know. Well, you get the idea. Anyway, another sort of intuitive way to think about R-naught is it's approximately, if you have a single case of disease in a totally healthy population, it's the expected number of people that they're going to infect. So if the typical infected person early in outbreak infects about one other person, then your R-naught is going to be close to one. And if your typical infected person infects somewhere around four other people, your R-naught is going to be close to four. And R-naughts, one of the first things that epidemiologists do when they get epidemiological data or they're investigating a new disease is try to estimate what that R-naught is, because that'll give them a sense of the timing. How long do they have till they can to get those vaccines online or to implement their other intervention strategies? And R-naughts for some of those really severe childhood diseases like polio, measles, they're estimated to be quite high, in excess of 5 or even 10. R-naught for flu is estimated to be much closer to 1. Estimates are typically between 1 and 2. So trick of the trade 3, supercomputing. So many of us in this room use big, powerful computers for lots of things, and they've really advanced our work in different ways. And it's always computing connected to methodological innovations, modeling advances. So I just want to mention a few ways in which supercomputing, using computers, has been quite useful in our field. So one is in implementing agent-based models. So some folks in our field have undertaken heroic attempts to model infectious disease transmission with a lot of detail, where you represent every single individual in the United States, their hourly movement patterns, and on top of that model how disease spreads. And that's something that's done quite a bit. Another area in which we use supercomputers is in visualization. And what I'm showing you here is a visualization that we developed. This is actually a video of a visualization tool that's interactive, that we developed in a project that we did with federal public health officials to try to figure out how to most effectively distribute the strategic national stockpile of antivirals during the 2009 pandemic. And we don't actually use these visualization tools to do any of our analysis, but they are absolutely critical in our effective communication with public health agencies. They help us to explain to them what the model's doing, to explain to them what the results are telling us, and really just allow us to break down what's been a historic barrier between science, and particularly between mathematical modeling and those out there on the front line making decisions about disease control. The other thing that we use supercomputing for is for optimization. So recently, there has been a greater use of large-scale optimization methods to try to search large policy spaces for the most effective uses of limited resources. So this antiviral example was that the U.S. has a strategic national stockpile of 80 million antivirals, okay? And when a pandemic starts unfolding, where and when should they send those courses? They could send them all out on day one to Chicago. They could give 10 million courses to the 10 biggest cities. Or they could distribute it pro rata, proportional to population size in small chunks. But you can imagine there's actually hundreds of millions of possible distribution schedules one could consider. And so by teaming up with folks from operations research, using supercomputing facilities, we can explore and actually using simulations of disease spreading through the United States, we can explore hundreds of millions of strategy options in a very short amount of time. And we also use optimization for estimating parameters when we're trying to use data to estimate parameters for complex models. So finally, trick of the trade 4. The most important thing in making our work relevant is having data that tell us what is really going on there. But our field is notoriously data limited. It's hard to find good quality epidemiological data. And when you do find it, people often don't want to share it. And so we look to all sorts of sources to try to get a better sense of what those contact patterns are, what those disease patterns are. We look to sociological data. But they're really, we're sort of entering a new era in epidemiology with the dawn of internet trend data, or internet source data, of cell phone data, of all these sort of electronic data sources that tell us something about who might be sick, where people are moving, and who's bumping into whom. And many of you may already know of this great example, but for those of you who don't, I want to tell you all about one of the coolest examples of using 21st century data to understand something about diseases. And that's the example of Google flu trends. So some folks at Google had this brilliant idea that they should look historically at how many people every day are searching for flu-related terms, fever, sore throat, Tamiflu, et cetera. And when they look at the number of queries every day for a long list, about 40 different search-related terms, what they find is the rate of queries, how many people are searching every day, mirrors the actual surveillance data for flu almost perfectly. So what you're seeing here are two plots. The yellow plot is that same time series I showed you earlier, the CDC's data on how many people are infected with flu. And what you see in blue is Google's data on how many people are searching for flu-related terms on a daily basis. And so this is really a wonderful source of additional information about what's going on with flu in the US. And this is down to sort of the level of cities you can get this kind of information. I will point out, though, a very important discrepancy here in the summer of 2009. So this is when the H1N1 pandemic was first emerging into the United States out of Mexico, and there was a lot of attention. There was a lot of media. So at that point in time, there are many more people actually Googling for information about the flu than are infected with flu. So while this is a potentially good addition to traditional surveillance sources of information, it could be quite misleading during high-profile events where people want information even when they're not sick. Okay, so finally in part three, and how am I doing on time, Maria? 7 minutes, okay, perfect. So part three, a very quick whirlwind tour. So how can folks like us get directly involved in projects that are impacting decision-making in public health? And there's many different ways. I mean, I think it's great that the WHO and the folks who are making vaccine decisions very rapidly, from what I heard from Derek, very rapidly identified him and brought him into the vaccine selection committee when they saw his paper on it. But often those opportunities don't come easily. I've been in Austin for 10 years, and I've been knocking on the door of the state agency saying, hey, we do some interesting work that might be useful for disease response and preparedness. Are you interested in talking to us? They've always been very nice, but they've never really been interested in doing anything. And so it's taken a long time of developing relationships, waiting for people who are more open to mathematical modeling to come into positions of influence in the division. So one is it just sometimes takes hard work and knocking at the door and showing them through visualizations that you are doing something that might be useful for them. And now there are more opportunities. The MIDAS program funded by NIH is specifically targeted at funding mathematical modeling research groups around the country that are doing modeling that can help advance our understanding and control of infectious diseases. And through that program, they not only fund research, but they bring the researchers to the table with public health officials during crisis times and non-crisis times to really help make that translation between what we're doing in universities to what they're doing on the front line. So, last year, we had an opportunity to do a set of four projects for the state of Texas, and I'm going to give you a very quick tour of those four projects just so you can get a sense of what's over there on the very applied end of the spectrum in our world. So the first project that we were asked to do was to evaluate and improve the flu surveillance system for the state of Texas. So where does this graph come from that I've shown you now a few times in this talk? Well, the CDC asked every state in the United States to set up a provider network, which means they just ask somewhere between tens or hundreds of doctor's offices or in clinics around the state to report every week how many flu-like cases do they see and how many cases do they see total. Then all 50 states send that data to the CDC, and that plot is basically just based on those numbers that they're getting from those doctor's offices around the state. The CDC gives very rough guidelines to the states. They say basically target providers in places where a lot of people live, okay? And so and that's essentially what Texas does. These spots on the map are the spots where we had different, where the providers were located for the 2008 surveillance network for Texas. And it's hard to tell here, but there's huge clusters of providers in the major metro areas of Houston and Dallas. And so we evaluated the surveillance network, and what they were specifically interested in is whether or not the data that were coming in through the ILINET actually reflected what was going on in terms of flu hospitalizations and flu deaths around the state. And we found that it did a decent job, but what we were able to do is actually, in the context of this project, is develop a really nice, very flexible optimization methodology using historical surveillance data to optimize provider selection, to strategically identify parts of the state that they should try to cover in order to get the best quality information about what's going on in flu in the state. So, for example, using this optimization methodology, we find that the state should be able to build a network of just 30 providers that will be much more informative than their actual network of about 200 providers. And so what's going on here? Well, what we found when you apply this method to Texas in particular is that flu is really, in the major metropolitan areas in Texas, Dallas, Houston, San Antonio, flu season looks exactly the same. They're totally in sync. So if you have a couple good providers in any one of those areas, you know what's going on everywhere else. And so there's no reason to put dozens of providers in all those cities. And then using historical information, we can figure out what parts of the state are out of sync with those major metropolitan areas and strategically add providers to the network that are giving complementary information. And we do find that the depending on what the goals are, whether what you want to do is surveillance throughout a typical flu season or early detection of the first cases in pandemic, you do end up with slightly different compositions of providers in the state. But the bottom line is you can do much better and you can be much more strategic and get much higher quality information if you take time and you look at the historical data. So Project 2, and this is sort of one of the holy grails of infectious disease research, is can we predict anything? You know, Derek is working on predicting which strains are going to be circulating next, but can we even predict how many hospitalizations we're going to see next week in Texas or next month? When is the flu season going to peak? How big is that peak going to be? What kind of surge are we going to experience in our hospitals and doctor's offices? And it's a really hard problem, and we're not very good at it. But we, as part of our contract for the state of Texas, we did work on trying to build a slightly better method for forecasting flu. And we put this in a user-friendly website so that they could make their own forecasts in the future. And so this is, I think the 2007-2008 season. That's the actual epi data for some part of Texas. This is how our forecaster does if we forecast out about, I think maybe that's 12 weeks before the peak. So it does a pretty good job of the timing, not quite the magnitude. And as we get closer to the peak, our forecaster starts to do a little bit better. So what is our forecaster doing? Well, it's a dynamic linear regression model using Kalman filter that we're actually taking into account multiple different sources of data. The ILINET, which is traditional surveillance data, we're in real time scraping the Google Flu Trends data. Humidity, which is known to correlate with flu activity in the school calendar, which I showed you strongly impacts the dynamics of flu. So taking these diverse sources of information, uploading them in real time so that the state can make forward projections of flu. And it's very interactive, and this is just a screenshot from the tool that they now have. The third project for them was to develop a simulator. Now this is by no means a forecaster. It's a large-scale simulation of the spread of flu through Texas. It's very detailed, a lot of demographic information, a lot of travel information, a lot of health information in there, and it's at the resolution of counties, as you can see here. There are about 200 in the state of Texas. And it's a simulator that allows the user to specify the epidemic parameters. How quickly is it spreading? How deadly is it for the different age groups, et cetera? And the user can also specify any number and impact of intervention measures. So they can specify that they want to implement, they want to vaccinate 100,000 people in this state, prioritizing kids first on this date, and then maybe distribute this many antivirals on another date, et cetera. So it allows them to play around with different scenarios and can be useful in their planning exercises. Now they know that this needs to be taken with an enormous grain of salt. This is not a forecaster. This will not tell them what's going to happen in that next pandemic, even if they get the parameters right, because we just don't have the information to build a forecaster on this at this resolution. But what it is very useful for, I think, is giving them some basic intuition about the dynamics of infectious disease and about how different kinds and magnitudes of interventions might impact the spread of disease. The final project that we did for the state was a tool for helping them make decisions about stockpiling. So one of the things that is really on the minds of preparedness folks is, are they going to have enough resources in place to handle what they call the surge? So in those peak weeks of a flu epidemic or any kind of epidemic, are there going to be enough people, enough beds, enough ventilators, enough space in hospitals for the sheer volume of cases they expect to get? So they need to be able to forecast what that volume is going to look like, and then they need to have the resources on hand. And there are a lot of different resources they're interested in having better tools for planning for. We focused on ventilators, which are used to keep people alive in ICUs who have very severe invasive cases of flu in their lungs. And the idea here is that the state wanted to know how many ventilators should they have on hand in a central stockpile to distribute out as needed to hospitals, and how much resources should they give to hospitals individually to stockpile their own. And the trade-off is, if it's central, you can send them where they need to be, you don't need as many. But there is the cost that if you get a ventilator to the right hospital, you may not have someone trained to use it, it may not actually get there, et cetera. So you're less sure that the ventilator will actually be used effectively. And so one of the things I particularly like, so there's two really cool things about this model. One, or this tool. One is that it's directly connected to the forecaster. So they can update their calculations as they get new forecasts as to what that peak might look like in terms of number of hospitalizations and cases needing ventilation. The other thing I really like about this is the user interface. So, I mean, I think this sort of indirectly gets to these questions about resilience. And one of the things, I know when I was involved in some of the robustness things in Now, I think there's some similar questions with resilience, is how do you quantify resilience? And I think it's really, I think one of the things in a very specific application here is how do you quantify how well prepared you are for this kind of event? And this allows, this tool allows the user to specify the margin of error that they're comfortable with, how resilient they want their system to be without us having to say what it is. So how does it work? Well, there's two different x-axes here, and the user can push their mouse anywhere they want along this x-axis, and they'll get a different recommendation depending on where they are. So one of them is in terms of expected unmet demand. So the user can say, I want to have an expected, I want to make sure that no more than 10 cases that need ventilators in the state of Texas are going to go unventilated. They put their mouse on 10 and they get a recommendation for how much they should stockpile. Alternatively, although it's the same model and same results, just presented on a different scale, they can specify the probability of unmet demand. That means I want to be 5% sure there's not even a single case in the state of Texas that goes unventilated. And then they get their recommendation based on where they put their mouse on the x-axis. So that's a tour of some of the projects we've done recently and where we're involved in other projects for the state. And some of the keys to successful collaboration that I've learned in my years of working effectively and not so effectively with public health agencies are, number one, continual dialogue with your partners in public health to define tractable, valuable projects. And the best projects, the best collaborations, are ones that have originated with the public health agency. Going back to the first study that I did, and Mark Newman was involved in with the CDC in 2003, they came to us with the problem. They said, we don't know how to control walking pneumonia in healthcare settings. We have all these possible strategies. Which one is the best? We don't have the data. We can't do the experiments to test it. So they come to you, and then you get excited about it, and then you move. And often you can sort of surpass their expectations. With the flu surveillance project, all they wanted to know was there a good correlation between the ILI and hospitalizations, but out of it came a methodology so that they can improve all of their surveillance systems if they so choose. Clear deliverables. So unlike academic research, it's very important when you're working with public health and folks out there in the real world, you clearly define what it is that everyone wants to get out of the project. It's much more interesting for us if there's the possibility of scientific discovery and dissemination, writing papers, et cetera. And if there's funding attached to it, it gives you resources to get people involved who can actually do the work, who can make that website, because you know your students might be web savvy, but there's nothing like getting a real expert over there in the supercomputer center to build the website for you. But also, I think even though for the public health agency giving you the funding, even though they're giving resources to you, they're much more invested in it and in making it successful if they're supporting the project. And like I said earlier, intuitive visualizations of the method and the results, letting them know, giving them an intuitive feel for what's under the hood, and so it doesn't seem like hocus pocus, you know, particularly when you're building mathematical models and working with people who don't have any experience there. And finally, the public health agencies seem to really like these sort of interactive tools. So it's not just a report telling them that they should put more providers in Houston, it's actually a tool that allows them to make decisions in the future as the situation changes. So in my closing slide, I just want to say, although we've been very focused on flu recently, the kinds of work that we do is being done by others for other diseases. And it's not just flu for which we want to have a good understanding of those contact patterns and the processes by which epidemics spread and can be better controlled. And it's not just flu where we want good surveillance. We want surveillance for all of our infectious and chronic diseases. We want to be able to forecast all sorts of diseases and tools for more effectively mitigating epidemics and improving public health are certainly valuable across the board. So I'll just close by acknowledging the long list of people from public health, from UT, from different academic departments and public health agencies around the country and also in Canada who've been involved in this work, and funding agencies, the NIH MIDAS program, NSF, the James McDonald Foundation, and SFI has been invaluable, not only in terms of actual financial support for some of this work, but certainly in creating an environment where this work could be possible. So thank you very much.
Hi, Lauren. Thanks. That was the stuff you're doing with Texas is really amazing and all the tools. I have a question about the network side of things. So contact network is not the same thing as the actual transmission network. So the transmission network is, you know, for any particular disease spread is going to be some subset of the network, of the contact network. Are people able to put together actual transmission networks, and is there any sort of understanding of the similarities or differences between a contact and a transmission network, and what might the implications be for thinking about the spread of disease?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So the answer is that there is some work that I'm aware of in this direction of taking, you know, you might know the transmission tree. You may not even know the transmission tree, but what you know is who got sick and when they got sick. And actually, you don't even know that. What you know is who was actually reported being sick and when they were reported. So you got to infer all the other steps in the transmission chain and who actually infected who. And of what I, you know, what I know of the work going on, it's really only a tractable problem at this point if you're dealing with something where you can observe many outbreaks. So, you know, if you just have one outbreak in one time series of who got infected when, it's very hard to infer anything. But if you have multiple outbreaks, you know, for example, like I said earlier, flu going through the same city year after year, or, you know, a school population you can sort of see with many different epidemics, you may have some hope of trying to do that inference. But it's a really hard problem, and I think we're just beginning to scratch the surface.
Hello. Hi, Lauren. Very interesting. So I was wondering whether your prediction tool, if you had told them all that you had a new strain, could you predict the different seasonality? Because one of the remarkable difficulties we have in modeling diseases is to explain seasonality, because everything is so regular. But I wonder whether if you assumed there was no immunity in the population, or if you took some of the other variables, you could actually predict that that new strain should have a different seasonality.
No, so the short answer is there's no way our model can do that. I think our model can do a decent job on seasonal flu. And in the one case of a pandemic that we have, if we shift our time indicator variable back from instead of having flu season sort of have its very early start when kids go back to school, if you shift it back to the first cases emerging in America, then it looks kind of like a flu, but so it worked in one case. So basically we don't have the data to be able to build the model. And this is really a data-driven model. So I think no, and actually, I'm actually going back to the health department to talk about whether they should even be using this forecaster. We haven't done it yet, but I'm very pessimistic that our model is actually going to be able to would have done a good job at the current season, because we didn't have a flu epidemic this year, and there's nothing in our model that would have predicted that. So I think although our model does a little bit better than published models on typical flu, none of these models really do very, very well on things that are anomalous.
Yeah. And then I wanted you to comment about, obviously the networks of transmission are very hierarchical. For some problems you are interested in a hospital, a city, but many problems people are looking at the globe or regional, using sequence data to establish the contact networks, etc. Obviously you don't want, depending on the question, you may use some of that, but when you are interested in pandemics and the sort of regional, very large scale, you don't want to use in the cities very detailed models. And so you need sort of formulations that take into account the heterogeneity of the networks, but in a simple model that can be incorporated at the larger scales. And I was wondering if you can comment a little bit about that aspect.
Yeah, so that's right. I mean, right now we sort of shoot from the hip in terms of deciding what level of resolution we want to develop our networks. So for that antiviral project where we were interested in distributing antivirals across the US, and we had a very short amount of time to do the analysis, we had an explicit network at the level of cities, and within cities we just used a very detailed age stratified compartmental model. Even though there are ways, analytic ways to now sort of put the full network into the cities, they're too computationally expensive. So we made that call, and it seemed reasonable at the time, but was it based on a rigorous sort of model comparison, model selection? No, and I think that's a really important area for future research is how do you decide what the appropriate level of resolution is for these models, and when you do, how can you parameterize them or build them so you're not ignoring that information you have at the lower level, but you're somehow extracting what the important features are from that lower level.
Question about stockpiling. I wonder whether if you stockpile in particular centers like hospitals, aren't you in some sense inducing aggregation where sick people go to and meet non-sick people, and you just increase the danger of this, the speed of the spread of the disease? I wonder, for example, if you know suddenly everyone goes to hospital centers to vaccinate in a surge case, you know, aren't you making things worse? Wouldn't it be better to train people to vaccinate each other, so to have your neighbor vaccinate you and vice versa, so to distribute that those tools?
Yeah, that's a very good point. So for this particular exercise, it was assumed that patients are going to go where they go. And given that they go where they usually go, are we going to have enough resources on hand to handle them? And patients are not being directed to hospitals with particularly large stockpiles. But I think your point is well taken. And one in some of the very active areas of thought in the sort of pandemic preparedness community is around the question of, instead of doing preparing for surge capacity, so making sure we have enough resources on hand for surges, why don't we do something strategic to avoid surges? So things like directing patients away from the hospitals they usually go to, or using nurse triage lines or hotlines, so they call in and the nurse is able to say, well, based on what you have, I'm just going to give you a prescription for antivirals and you don't need to go to a doctor's office. So you know that is to diminish the load on the system and also to reduce opportunities for transmission in these healthcare settings. So There's a really active discussion around that right now, but there's nothing really. They're just starting to move forward on those fronts to kind of shift the focus away from surge capacity. Thank you.